محمد. Respected Mu'mineen, brothers and sisters, scholars, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would like to first of all send our condolences to the Imam of our time over the sad demise of our respected Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I would like to, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. I am here today to make a very short announcement. We have an organization called the Muslim Convention, which has been running now for the past in 2018 and 2019. Unfortunately, due to the COVID crisis, we've had to suspend the convention. It was held recently in Manchester. Alhamdulillah, this year we are blessed to have the convention taking place in Birmingham this year. And the theme of the convention will be the living hope, the Mahdi. The focus will be obviously about the Imam of our time, alayhi salam, and it will discuss an array and a number of topics. The main vision for such a convention is to allow a national Shia community to come together into a central place where you can meet and greet other people of similar beliefs, but also engage with a huge and large number of speakers that we have invited for the event. These are some of the pictures that we can see from the last two conventions that were held in Manchester, which was happened, as I said, in 2018 and 2019. The schedule for the event will be, obviously the event will take place on the 23rd of October 2022, which is a Sunday, almost a month away from now. The schedule will start, the event will start from 9:15 in the morning and will finish with Maghribain, inshallah. We have two sessions before Salat, before noon prayers. The first session will be a panel talk show and have a ring of speakers. We have Sayyid Zafar from Birmingham. We had Sheikh Nuru also from here. We have Sheikh, respected Sheikh Mohammed Al-Hilli, who is with us today. And we have Brother Jalal, Had Jalal from America, and Sister Naseem Walji also from here. And that will be chaired by Sister Zahra Al-Alawi. The second session will be short talks, and it will have speakers like Dr. Murtaza Al-Dina, Sayyid Ahmed Al-Ashkouri, who is a leading scholar from the Holy City of Najaf. We have Sayyid Munir Al-Khabbaz, who again is a senior scholar from the city of Najaf, currently living in Saudi Arabia. And we have Sayyid Shahan Shahan Naqwi. I believe some people may know him. He's a very popular speaker from Pakistan. We have Professor Hassan Abbas, Sayyid Haider Baharoom, and your very own Shahan Abbas. He'll be chairing the sessions, inshallah. And in the morning, he also will welcome the crowds, seeing he's a Birmingham person, inshallah. So we also have a vast array of workshops that will take place immediately after the two sessions. Obviously, we'll have namaz first, then we'll have some lunch, and then we'll have up to 11 workshops taking place concurrently at the same time. You can only go to one workshop, unfortunately, so we'll have 11 different rooms, and the workshops, you can see, they cover a variety of topics: the impact of trauma, leadership in our community, empowering the disabled, challenging facing the revert communities, how to fulfill your potential, how to support all the Hazara communities, a story of racism and Shia phobia, anxiety, and again, and a vast array of topics, and you can register online before you attend to choose what workshop you're going to attend. These are some of the speakers we have, alhamdulillah, secured. Each workshop has two speakers and a chair. So you can imagine that we're going to be hitting over 40 different speakers from all over the world. Again, it's a wonderful opportunity when you come, you register, you attend, you get to meet a number of speakers, you engage in different topics, and you get to discuss them openly with everyone. After that, we have a grand celebration. So we have different reciters coming. We have Brother Nazar Qatari, Farhan Ali Waris, Sayyid Jalal, Brother Ali Fadl, and Rashid Haider from London. And again, it will be 10 days after the Kushali of the Prophet. And that time, we will celebrate his birth. Obviously, the theme of the convention is about our Mahdi, but that celebration will be about the Prophet. And so, as I said, it will start in the morning at 9:15, we should finish by 6 o'clock. And it's at the same time, we also have a parallel program for children, kids, and youth. So if you want to drop your child off into the creche system, you can leave them the whole day, you pick them up for lunch. There's a youth program for 5 to 10-year-olds, and there is also a program for teenagers. So again, you know, if you want to, if your kids, obviously the sessions are not tailored for them, but these specific programs are, inshallah, so we can keep the whole family engaged the whole day, inshallah. The entry is at cost. We've hired the east side rooms, which are, I believe, just under 9 minutes away from here. It's a massive venue. The hall could take up to 1,200 people, but also multiple, there'll be multiple breakout rooms. So we need to cover the costs, and we require, inshallah, the mu'mineen, when they to purchase a ticket, the costs are £30 per adult, 25 for a student. If you're a family, there's a discount, inshallah. Again, Sunday, 23rd of October, just under a month away, and you can book your ticket right now, themuslimcon.org. You can also follow us on Instagram with the same handle. I believe there's leaflets outside, which has all the information I've said, and we'll be here, inshallah, this evening. If you have any questions, you know, and at the end of the day, this is a convention held in Birmingham, so we expect and we hope that to see as many people there as possible, inshallah. Thank you very much. And before I finish, I just want to share with you the list of partners that we have. So we have national partners that we've worked with and also local partners. And alhamdulillah, we managed to get all the local community centers, the majority of them based in Birmingham. And I'm sure you can recognize all these groups, inshallah, here. As I said, any further questions, I'll be available after the program and hopefully to see you there. Thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف خلقه وخاتم أنبيائه وسيد رسله سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين وحبيب إله العالمين الشاهد والمشهود والحامد والمحمود البشير النذير والسراج المنير خاتم النبيين رحمة للعالمين سيد المرسلين القوي المتين سيد الكونين أبا الزهراء وجد الحسنين شفيع المؤمنين الصادق الأمين العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد والمصطفى الأمجد والمحمود الأحمد المصطفى أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين المكرمين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا قال الله العظيم في كتابه الكريم وهو أحسن القائلين وأصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولا تكن للخائنين خصيما واستغفر الله إن الله كان غفارا رحيما آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم for the purification of the souls, the enlightenment of the hearts, for the acceptance of the deeds and for the hastening of the reappearance of the awaited Savior, Ajallahu Ta'ala Farajah Sharif. Enlighten your souls, purify the atmosphere with the recitation of salawat upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Respected scholars, elders, sisters and brothers, salamun alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Does the Holy Prophet of Islam make errors and mistakes in his personal life and in dealing with matters not related to religion? When it comes to the subject of the illustrious life and the biography of the greatest human being, Rasul al-A'zam wa Nabi al-Akram Muhammad al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. There's no doubt there isn't a single human being like the Holy Prophet. What a man the Prophet of Islam indeed was. A person that indeed continues to be today the inspiration for hundreds of millions to observe and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. An individual who today is the role model and exemplar for so many human beings throughout history. And when you look at the world today, when we see so many Muslims, it all started with one man. This human being is truly exceptional, is truly a wonderful individual that you and I are indeed proud to be called Muhammadi. People who are associated with this great individual. I tell you, you look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses his prophets. When he addresses his prophets, he mentions them by name. For example, he says, Ya Isa. He says, Ya Musa. He says, Ya Ibrahim. There isn't a single instance in the Quran where Allah says, Ya Muhammad. Every time the Quran says, Ya Ayyuhan Nabi, Ya Ayyuhan Rasul. Why? Allah is saying the level of the Holy Prophet of Islam is another level. I address him by what? What I have bestowed upon him. And that is the fact that he is a prophet and he's a messenger. And the other prophets are great. But the Holy Prophet of Islam is definitely the greatest. And that's why you find that he has this special position, this special status within the religion of Islam, one that you and I have been told and taught throughout our lives. And indeed, we have to be also grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for being individuals who are the followers of this great individual. Sometimes we take it for granted. You and I may take it lightly that we are the followers of the Prophet of Islam, that we have grown to love this holy individual, to follow him, to indeed emulate and to look at his practices and to practice whatever we can. There's no doubt that there is a great need for gratitude for you and I, for he, this great individual, shed tears for you and I. Because the narration says, when he was sitting with his companions, he would cry. They would say to him, Ya Rasulullah, why are you crying? He would say, I wish I can meet my brothers. They say, surely we are your brothers. He said, no, my brothers and sisters are those that come after me, believe in me, yet they have never seen me. This is an honor for you and I to indeed become those who are Muhammadi, following in the footsteps of this great human being, Rasul al-A'zam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Having said this, you would expect that the best human being and the greatest and the one that is inspiring the world's largest growing religion today had a last few days which are deserving of his personality and character. When we examine history and the biography of the Holy Prophet, we find that the last few days of the life of the illustrious Prophet of Islam was not something that many would expect to see or hear, no doubt. There are a number of things that happen in the last few days of the life of the Messenger of God that today our hearts are broken for. When he requests a pen and paper, he is told that you have become delirious. When he sends an army towards the Roman Byzantines, headed by Usama ibn Zayd, many companions refuse. When he appoints his successor, the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has appointed, people turn against him. The realization, therefore, is that those few days towards the end of the life of this great individual demonstrated a problem that existed in society and one that you and I need to discuss today. What do you mean? I was watching yesterday a lecture by an individual who is respected in the Muslim world, Dr. Yasir Qadhi. He was analyzing the personality of Yazid. What he said was that Yazid and the analysis of Karbala and Ashura has nothing to do with theology. It's history. Theology ends with the Prophet. There is no connection with Aqidah and belief when it comes to those individuals, Karbala, 10th of Muharram, and what happened. He emphasized this time and time again in order for the audience to ensure that this message is what well understood. When it comes to the Holy Prophet of Islam, however, there is no dispute that his life is sunnah. His teachings are those that you and I have to look at and indeed apply into our lives. Everything he said, everything he did, everything that he said we must not do is part of the sunnah of the Holy Prophet. Yet, the last few days indicates a problem in the aqidah that you and I need to discuss, that today is a subject of controversy within the Muslim world. What is that? That is in relation to whether the Prophet of Islam makes mistakes or errors outside the fold of his tabligh and the dissemination and the spreading of the teachings of the religion of Islam. What do you mean? The idea today that exists is what? Is that the belief in the Isma of the Holy Prophet is a subject that has been discussed extensively between Muslim scholars for 1400 years, no doubt. Yet today there exists a rising call to re-evaluate and to re-examine the subject, particularly in the dimension of the life of the Holy Prophet of Islam that is not related to him teaching people Islam. In which way do we mean? There are many schools of thought who believe that the Prophet is indeed ma'soom. There are many who believe that he is error-free. Yet when it comes to the exact definition of his isma, there is a wide spectrum within the Muslim world. This was demonstrated towards the end of his life, when there was a refusal to give him a pen and paper in the event of the calamity of Thursday, agreed upon by all Muslims, and when there was a refusal to accept his command to go and fight, and when there was a denial of his command to take Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Is an indication of a bigger problem that began to emerge in society and today exists. And no doubt today there is also this belief that exists amongst a group of the followers of the Ahlul Bayt. There are those who have began to call for this to be re-examined. In particular, they reference a story in the Quran which they say proves that the Prophet of Islam did not make the right decisions, God forbid, and he made errors and mistakes when it comes to matters outside the fold of religion. What is that story? That story is in relation to Surah An-Nisa, verse 105 and 106. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in these two particular ayat of the Quran, a story that's found in hadith. What's the story? In hadith, it is said that there was a man from a tribe of Bani al-Ibriq. He went and stole a shield in Medina. When he stole a shield, what did he do? He was someone who was then accused of stealing the shield. In order to exonerate himself, he placed the shield in the house of a Jewish man in Medina. When he placed the shield in the house of a Jewish man, they went and found the shield in this person's house. They took this man to the Holy Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, this shield was found in this Jewish man's house and it was stolen. You judge. The hadith in Sunni and some Shia literature say the Prophet of Islam said the Jewish man is to blame. He is the thief. Therefore, what happened? They say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed those verses. وَلَا تَكُنْ لِلْخَائِنِينَ خَصِيمًا. Don't be an advocate for those traitors. وَاسْتَغْفِرِ اللَّهِ. Seek forgiveness from Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ غَفَّارًا رَحِيمًا. Allah is of forgiving, of merciful. The conclusion that emerges from this discussion and others is, look, the Prophet of Islam here is making a judgment. This judgment is nothing to do with the fact that he's a prophet, they say. And therefore, it was corrected by God. It was not the right decision, because clearly the Jewish man was not the thief. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him so in this ayah. This subject I'd like to discuss in detail. Why? Because when it comes to discussions relating aqa'id, there are those amongst us, especially the youth, who feel it goes above their head. What do you mean? I remember sitting with a number of youth just now in Ziyarah, in Iraq, and before in America where I was in Muharram, and I love to ask this question to the youngsters. What kind of discussions do you like to have from the minbar? In Muharram, in Safar, in Fatimiyya, in Arba'een, Thursday nights, other programs, Shahadat, Kushali, what kind of discussions? And the thing that emerges usually is, Mawlana, what we want is spirituality. We want to get closer to Allah. I remember in one US center, they invited me to go and speak Muharram. I looked at their YouTube, that's what I do normally before I go, and I see what topics they haven't covered. I noticed that in the last 10 years, no one's spoken about Akhirah. Not a single majlis. death, nothing. And everything was about music, relationships, LGBT. That's it. So I went and I decided to give a series on what? On the hereafter. 5 nights in, the Mawlana is there, called me to the office. He said, Sheikh, everyone wants lectures on music and LGBT. I said, what do you mean? He said, social issues, spirituality. Why are we not giving those? I remember also two years ago in Fatimiyah in Canada, I gave a majlis on the dissection of the opinion of Amir al-Mu'mineen in Nahj al-Balagha regarding women. Did he say that women are half or deficient in faith, deficient in intellect? Did he say this or not? I received an email from a well-intentioned individual from the community. Yes? He said to me, I wasted 1 hour of my life. I said to him, why? He said in the email, why did you have to tell us about this? Tell me something that gets me close to God. What is it beneficial for me to learn that Amir al-Mu'mineen had this opinion about women or not? Tell me practical tips. Today, on Instagram, that's what really hits. Yes? Things that people love to see in here, personal development, spirituality, and social issues. Yes? What is the problem with this? There's no doubt that you and I require these elements in our lives. There's no doubt there is a role within our minbar and teachings and madrasa for spirituality. There is no doubt that we need to discuss social issues. They are of the paramount importance. They should never be disregarded. Yet what comes first is aqidah. What comes first is doctrines and beliefs. You know why? Without aqidah, without a sound belief, forget spirituality and forget social issues. You ask me how? I can't get close to Allah without aqidah. You can't get close to Allah. You cannot. Don't even try. This foundation, which is your aqidah and belief, needs to be strong, needs to be firm. Someone asks me, what does that mean? I need to be able to defend Rasulullah's asma for me to be able to get close to Allah and to the Holy Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt. I need to be an individual who understands my doctrines, my usul deen firmly. Someone said to me, no, I don't need to. I'll call a Mawlana, ask the audience, or 50-50. Ajib. This is an easy way out for people, isn't it? That I don't need to refer to my knowledge. I immediately ask somebody else. I don't need to have that particular strength when it comes to my aqidah. Today, what we have to reiterate, my dear sisters and brothers, with full love, to all my mu'mineen, brothers and sisters, especially the youth, what we have to go back is back to basics and essentials. Yes? There is no doubt that the member should discuss spirituality. No doubt the member should discuss social issues. But a member devoid of aqidah has missed the point. Yes? Our aqidah needs to be firm. Why? Someone asks. Why? Tell me, what is the reason? Number one, we'll be asked about these on the day of Qiyamah and before it in Barzakh. We'll be held accountable, yes? We are not individuals who will be able to, what? Run away from these questions. Number two, the world today is filled with misconceptions about theology, about aqa'id, about beliefs. There are people questioning all kinds of beliefs when it comes to our doctrines, wherever we go, whether it's in university campuses, whether in schools, whether at the workplace, whether it's online. You and I need to be equipped with the tools. Our children need to be equipped with the tools. Member is one way, workshops is another. We need to have what? Dialogues. We need to have discussions where people are able to ask questions to strengthen, yes, their understanding of faith. When was the last time we had refresher courses for adults when it comes to aqidah? When was the last time, yes, we revised our understanding of tawheed, of justice of God? Just now, this devastating floods in Pakistan. I was in America. Someone grabbed me after the majlis and said, my daughter is close to leaving Islam. Wallah, from the member of the Prophet, I said, why? She said, where is God? Why is he not stopping these floods in Pakistan? Why? Why is he letting so many people suffer? Where is the justice of God? Today we have what? A rising atheist movement in campuses and universities. Today we have theological discussions that need to be had, yes? And therefore, this kind of subject is of the utmost importance. Why? Because the school of Ahlul Bayt and the Ahlul Bayt themselves engaged in it. How many debates we hear from, for example, the six holy Imam, Ja'far ibn Muhammad and al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. In which he would sit with atheists, agnostics, people of other faiths, people within the religion of Islam. And therefore, doctrines and aqa'id need to be highlighted, needs to be discussed. And on this note, I'd like to encourage my respected sisters and brothers to indeed take part in this upcoming mainstay convention, Muslim convention. Yes, this important program addresses a number of key issues that are relevant to you and I. And it is headed through a theological concept, yes? The belief in the Holy 12th Imam is essential, and it's been shaken by certain individuals around the world today from within the school of Ahlul Bayt. And therefore, let's encourage our sisters and brothers, our children, to take part, yes? And to ensure that this convention, inshallah, is successful. I would like to look at this story. Because if you haven't heard of this story, it's important that we analyze it. And we present the opinion of our ulama and theologians today. Because when it comes to our ulama, perhaps throughout history, there's been a slight difference of opinion. What do you mean? Today you ask me, the isma of the Holy Prophet, is it defined or translated in English as infallibility? I say to you, no. The first thing that we have to recognize is that the word isma means error-free, sinlessness. It is not infallibility. Infallibility means unable to err. Whereas the belief in the Islamic theological system is that the Anbiya and the Imma within the school of Ahlul Bayt, the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam themselves, are able to err, but they never do or never think of it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them divine knowledge, this divine grace, that they're able to see the ramifications and the consequences of sinning. No doubt we need to make sure that the terminology used is correct. Someone asks, but can you make it easier for me? Shah Ramadan. Shah Ramadan, you and I are fasting. Most of us, when we're alone and there's no one watching, and perhaps there is a delicious meal that we love in front of us. Let's say mandazi, yes? Something that you love in front of you. There is nobody watching. How do you feel? You will not eat it because you know Allah is watching. There is a degree of isma in your life. You are not going to commit that sin. Nobody's watching, yes? You are holding yourself from the breaking of the fast in the month of Ramadan, despite the temptation to do so. The Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam, yes, are able to commit sins, but they don't. Yes, the Quran tells us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs the Holy Prophet, Ya ayyuha Rasul, balligh ma unzila ilayka min rabbik, wa in lam taf'al, fama balaghta risalata. Allah gives the Prophet a choice on the day of Ghadir. He says, deliver the message, but if you don't, everything will be nullified. The reason why Allah says to him, you don't, is because the Prophet had a choice. If the Prophet had no choice, Allah would not say to him, and if you don't. Therefore, it is what? It is within our aqidah and belief that the Ahlul Bayt alayhum salam are able to sin, but they never even think about sinning. Just like how sometimes we, in a much lesser degree, in the month of Ramadan, we don't even think about breaking our fast. It doesn't even come to our minds. Question: do all Muslims believe in the isma of the Holy Prophet, meaning that he's error-free, sinless? There are four categories of beliefs. Please understand this so that you'll know where we are different. When I say we, I mean the majority of our ulama today as Shia theologians. The first is sins, disobedience, dhunub. When it comes to Muslim theologians throughout history, what do they believe? They believe that the Holy Prophet of Islam, some of them, the Ash'arites, believe after 40 he is ma'soom. Before 40, they say he committed sins and then sought forgiveness. The Mu'tazilites have a slightly different opinion to what? To the Ash'arites. When it comes to the school of Ahlul Bayt, we believe no. From birth, the Prophet of Islam and all the prophets, as well as the Ahlul Bayt, yes, the 14, are sinless. They did never commit any sins or disobedience. Why? Someone says, but look at the Quran. Allah says in Surah Al-Fath, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمِ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Quran is filled with ayat in which seemingly you'll get an idea that the Prophet did commit mistakes. And it's so important to research. It's so important to ask. It's so important not to jump into conclusions because of a YouTube video. Sometimes people panic. I say to them, take a chill pill. Relax and research. The double R. Yes? Relax and research. Don't, Mawlana, someone has just shaken our aqeedah. Allahu Akbar. 1400 years cannot be shaken by YouTube. In the recognition that today, what do we find? We find that this first category, there's a disagreement. The second category is what? The second category is the receiving of the revelation and the delivering. What do you mean? Today there's a concept known as Chinese whispers. When somebody says something to someone and it's passed to someone else and it's passed to someone else, by the time it reaches the 15th person, it's a totally different message. Here, there are many Muslims who believe that the Holy Prophet of Islam is indeed ma'soom when receiving the message. And he's ma'soom when delivering the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say this is very, very important. Hence, the majority of Muslims reject the so-called satanic verses. Those particular references that are found in Tabari that indeed was used by this particular individual in his book. Yes, in the recognition that they say this cannot be accepted. How can the Prophet of Islam not know what is Quran and what is not Quran? They cite a particular hadith here that is found where? That is found in many books of hadith. Here this hadith says that Ibn Abbas was asked by people, do you write whatever the Prophet tells you? He thought with himself. Then he went and asked the Prophet. He said, Ya Rasulullah, should I write everything that you tell me? In other words, whatever comes out of you is true. The Prophet of Islam goes forward and says to him, yes, فَوَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ, I swear by the one who created me, لَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهُ إِلَّا الْحَقِّ, nothing comes out of here except the truth. Yes, write it down. It's all truth. It's all acceptable. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Jinn, what does he say? The final ayah, he says, عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَىٰ غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا إِلَّا مَنْ ارْتَضَى مِنْ رَسُولٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this knowledge, yes, that he has, this ilm al-ghayb, he does not give it to anyone except those whom he wishes. Then he says he will protect this knowledge that he gives to whomsoever he gives it. And therefore, there is no doubt about the second category. The third category is what? This is very controversial. Please pay attention to this point. The third category is the application of religion and Islam, such as Salah, such as Ahkam. Yes. Many of the Muslim world, Ash'arites, Mu'tazilites and others, believe that the Prophet of Islam makes mistakes in the conduction of Sharia. What do you mean? For example, volume 1 of Bukhari, volume 4 of Sahih Muslim, they say the Prophet of Islam, for example, forgot to do wudu once, forgot to do ghusl once. Instead of 4 rak'at of dhuhr, he prayed 2. Then he was reminded, that, by the way, you only prayed 2, for example. He forgot some verses of the Holy Quran, for instance. They say that the Prophet of Islam, they believe, when it comes to delivering the message and practicing it, made errors and mistakes. The school of Ahlul Bayt here has what? Has a very important position now that may have not been the position in the past. For example, we have Sheikh al-Saduq, alallahu ta'ala maqama, one of our great ulama. Sheikh al-Saduq believed that the Prophet made mistakes in Salah. This was something that he wrote about and he vehemently defended it. Yes. However, Sheikh al-Mufid replied to him, yes, a very strong rebuttal to prove that this cannot be accepted. Today, our theologians, the vast majority of our fuqaha and our ulama from the school of Ahlul Bayt say this cannot be accepted. Why? They say, look at the evidence in the Holy Quran. In chapter 3, verse 21, and I'm referring to many verses so that you and I are Ahlul Quran. We refer back to the Quran when it comes to our aqeedah, supported by the hadith of the Ahlul Bayt, alayhum salam. The Holy Quran in chapter 3, verse 21 says what? لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. You have the best example in the Prophet of God. How is it possible that the Prophet makes mistakes in prayers and he is the best example? If today you and I perfect our prayers and not make any mistakes in our prayers, that makes them potentially better than the Prophet of Islam. Similarly, Allah says in chapter 107, verse number 5, an ayah that most of us have memorized, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَهُونَ. Woe be to those who pray and take their prayers lightly. These mistakes, these errors, yes, are problematic. Because the Prophet of Islam is the best, is the purest, is the creme de la creme. He is the role model for you and I. How can I ever accept that he makes mistakes in prayers? Because he's my teacher. He's someone who's teaching me and you and I how to perform the salah. And therefore, the third category is what? A matter that we have discussed. But the fourth is very important. The fourth is where the school of Ahlul Bayt stands unique. And when I say school of Ahlul Bayt, I mean the majority of our mutakallimeen, majority of our fuqaha and our theologists today. What is the fourth? His personal life. Areas outside the teachings of the religion, areas outside the delivery of the message. This is very, very important. Why is this important? Because when it comes to other schools of thought, they come forward and they say, no, the Prophet of Islam at any age, whether it was after 40 or before 40, when he would give rulings, he would err, God forbid, when he would, for example, give advice to people about crops or fertilization of plants, he would make mistakes such as in Sahih Muslim. However, today, we have a very important belief within the school of Ahlul Bayt, you and I need to understand. And it's been this belief for centuries, yes? Yes, there are one or two of our scholars that may have differed. But generally, this is the understanding today. They say no. The ma'soom, the one chosen by Allah, purified by Allah, selected by Allah, is an individual who's error-free, sinless, does not make any mistakes, deliberately or inadvertently, in matters of religion and matters outside religion, in his personal life and his role as a muballigh, his role as the teacher, his role as the messenger. Someone asks, what is the proof from the Quran? We need proof from the Quran. Yes, we have to have proof from the Quran. Here we have a number of very important verses that highlights that the Prophet of Islam is categorically what? Ma'soom. Chapter 4, verse number 64. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. We have not sent a messenger except that they must be the subject of obedience of people by the permission of Allah. Does it say only certain times? No, it's mutlaq. It's all the time. We find Surah An-Nisa, verse number 80. مَنْ يُطِعَ الرَّسُولِ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whomsoever obeys the messenger, obeys Allah. Categorical. Does not say only at certain times, only matters of religion. Yes. Chapter 53, verse number 3 and 4. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. He does not speak of his own desire. It's all revelation. Surah Yasin. We have memorized Surah Yasin, yes? Yasin, والقرآن الحكيم. إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. What? عَلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. What does that mean, siratul mustaqim? It means you're always on the right path. Does the Quran have an asterisk, you know, terms and conditions apply? Only sometimes he deviates, God forbid? No. Allah says you're always on siratul mustaqim. At all times, 24 hours a day, all your life. Never did the Quran say there are exceptions that apply. Please understand this. Someone tells you, no. But you know there are these riwayat. Tell them, forget the riwayat. The Quran is saying the Prophet of Islam is always on Surat al-Mustaqim. He does not speak from himself. Everything is pure. Everything is from Allah. How can you accept anything otherwise, even if it's in narrations? Tell me how. And this is absolutely critical when it comes to what? When it comes to this story. What do we mean? This story has to be understood. Why does it have to be understood? Because it's used today by certain individuals, certain scholars, others, who have come forward and said, what, within the school of Ahlul Bayt, and said, this story is proof that the Prophet of Islam made errors and judgments. And these verses in the Quran highlight this. I need you to understand this story. I know theology and aqaid is not necessarily the most interesting of subjects, but they are of the most importance for you and I. Yes, no doubt. You and I need to be equipped with the necessary tools to be able to be called the defenders of Rasulullah.
the defenders of the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam. Our aqaid needs to be strong and make sure that our children, when they have these questions, we also, what, are able to answer these questions. So if someone asks you, therefore, when it comes to Surah An-Nisa, verse 105 and 106, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the Prophet, وَلَا تَكُنْ لِلْخَائِنِينَ خَصِيمًا. Don't be a supporter for the traitors. وَاسْتَغْفِرِ اللَّهِ. You must ask for tawbah. How do you respond? What would you say when someone says to you, the Quran says to the Prophet, seek istighfar. The Quran is saying, does anyone seek istighfar other than for sins? Normally, you commit sins and mistakes, disobedience of God, and therefore you need to ask for repentance, don't you? How do we respond to this? Let's look at this through a number of what answers. Number one, the riwayat that tell us this story, that there was a Jewish man with a shield, that he had what, been accused, and then the Prophet of Islam said, you are the one who is the thief, are all weak. They're not strong in their chain of narration. They are ضعيفة السند. They cannot be accepted. That's number one. Number two, they are contradictory. I personally found three different narrations about this story. So for example, another narration says that three brothers stole a shield. Then, when they were about to be caught, they put it in the house of someone else, yes, who's not a Jewish man. And when that person went to the Holy Prophet and complained, they accused him, that individual. So, the story is full of contradictions, cannot be accepted due to many different versions. However, there is a need to look at the ayat, because otherwise people say, very well, if you say that the story cannot be accepted, how can you interpret the verses then? The verses are saying that what? Do not support the traitors. How do we look at these ayat? Please bear with me so that we are Ahlul Quran. We understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran here says what? He says that we لِتَحْكُمَ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ بِمَا أَرَاكَ اللَّهِ. In the beginning of this particular verse, 105 of Surah An-Nisa, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, we have sent you so that you judge between people with that which Allah has commanded you, with that in which Allah has shown you. Please understand. Allah is saying, I show you the path. I don't abandon you. I will never let you make that judgment, yes, unless I give you direction. Here, I have to open a bracket. Please focus on this. This is a very difficult subject discussed by ulama. When the Prophet or an Imam has to rule between people, does he use his ilm, which is of the unseen, or does he judge through what is apparent, zahir? Which one? Some people say, for example, the Prophet would know that the Jewish man, if the story is acceptable, is not the thief who has stolen the shield. So surely he would use his ilm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him in order to exonerate this particular individual and say, you're not the thief. Yes. In some cases where it does not involve the Prophet making a mistake or error or undermining the position of Rasulullah or the Ahlul Bayt, they apply what? Zahiri rulings as apparent. Yes. In order to teach people. But if it involves any form of reprimand, if it involves any form of what? Sins or disobedience or mistakes or errors, this can never be accepted. Because someone just now in Ziyarah said to me, you know, you guys need to take a relaxing position on this. I said, why? He said, the Prophet makes mistakes in Salah and other places to teach people what to do if they make mistakes. That's a very interesting opinion now that emerges. He says, how can we know what to do after we make mistakes if the Prophet himself didn't make mistakes and therefore would say to people, if you make these mistakes, then you correct it this way. I say to him, you don't have to make the mistake to teach people how to correct a mistake. There's nothing out there that says, by the way, I can't tell you how to do, for example, sajdatay sahu unless I make a mistake and I do it before you. No, there are many things that the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt taught that they themselves didn't necessarily do. Yes, it's impossible for them to apply and to actually practice every single ruling. Because they were asked many times, what is the ruling here? What is the ruling there? What do we do there? If someone does this, if someone does that. It's impossible for the Ahlul Bayt to actually go through every single scenario and practice it themselves. They could tell you and I, no. But it undermines a very important belief, and that's Asma. I cannot just simply believe that the Prophet makes mistakes or errors in Salah so that he is teaching you and I. That's not acceptable, because Allah has chosen them, and anyone that is chosen by Allah has to be pure, because Allah is pure. Yes. That is what? Without a shadow of a doubt. That we have to go back to the Quran now. What does it mean when it says, وَلَا تَكُنْ لِلْخَائِنِينَ خَصِيمًا? Don't be a supporter for the traitors. If anybody understands some background in the Arabic language, they'll recognize that in the Quran there is a very special tool. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says, وَلَا تَكُنْ لِلْخَائِنِينَ خَصِيمًا, he is saying, you will not be a supporter for the traitors. You will never be, yes. It's not saying, and don't be. It's not instructing the Prophet of Islam. It's saying you, as the greatest human being, will never be a supporter for the traitors. In fact, when we look at this ayah, and we look at the next ayah, which is in ayah 113, in Surah An-Nisa, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? لَهَمَّ الطَّائِفَ وَلَوْلَا فَضُّ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ وَرَحْمَتُهُ لَهَمَّ الطَّائِفَةٌ مِّنْهُمْ أَنْ يُضِلُّوكَ. Sometimes people take things out of context. They remove things, yes, and they do not necessarily understand where it came from. Here the Quran, what does it say? It says, if it wasn't for the blessings and the grace of God upon you, some people would have tried to deviate you. وَمَا يُضِلُّونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ. But they never deviate except themselves. Then the Quran continues and says, وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمْ. And Allah taught you that which you did not know. This is where Ayah 113 of Surah An-Nisa, just a few ayat after this particular story. In fact, this ayah and the one before it, 15, 105 and 106, as well as 113 of Surah An-Nisa, demonstrates the isma of the Holy Prophet. Say to me, how? Allah says, I have given you knowledge. وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that if it wasn't for my direction to you, you would have been what? Taken onto that direction is what? That isma. That direction is the error-free, sinless grace from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The final problem we have, and that is verse 106. Wastaghfirullah. Yes? How do we interpret this? Because you see, the Quran is full of mutashabih verses. Mutashabih means ambiguous. We must never look at these verses, because we have the story, for example, Ibrahim. He said, I am sick. Was he sick? We have Musa. He thumped someone. And what? That person died. Did he commit an error or a mistake or a sin? Yes. We have, for example, Yunus alayhi salam. Wa dhunni idh dhahaba mughadiban. He left his community hastily. These ayat must be studied very carefully. Yes. Must be analyzed with the opinion of the Ahl al-Bayt, school of Ahl al-Bayt, from our theologians and ulama. Here, the final ayah needs to be understood in order for us to be in the footsteps of the greatest messenger of God, Ar-Rasul al-A'zam Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. There is... There is a request for the brothers. I know you've been asked many times before, but inshallah, every step you take towards the minbar, a hadith I've just made up, you'll get thawab, inshallah. Please come forward as much as you can towards the minbar with the salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
A second salawat in honor of the Holy Prophet of Islam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
A third salawat to hasten the appearance of our 12th Holy Imam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
The final area of our discussion is istighfar. The Quran here and in many other places tells the Holy Prophet of Islam, wastaghfirullah. Yes, perform istighfar. How is this understood today? The word istighfar in the Arabic language has a number of meanings, just like many other words that we and I have come across. For example, mawla. The word Mawla has over 19 meanings in the Arabic language. Remember, may Allah bless this particular young man who understood aqaid and was able to defend the school of Ahlul Bayt. This young boy was in a country which was practicing Shia phobia. At school, he was somebody who was told by his teacher that when the Prophet said, "Man kuntu Mawlah, fahadha Aliyun Mawlah," it meant that whomsoever I am the friend of, Ali is the friend of. And this was what he was taught in school. One time, his teacher said to him, "I would like you to take my role for a few minutes as I leave the class." And he informed the class that everyone must be obedient to the student. It so happens in Middle East and other countries that sometimes a student is selected to be representing the teacher when the teacher leaves. I remember when I was in Iran as a child, this is what happened. I used to sometimes be selected, and everyone must be obedient to me. Whatever I say, everyone must be what? Obedient. The child stood there. He was only 12, 13. The teacher came back a few minutes later, said to him, "Sit down." Before sitting down, he looked at him and said, "Sir, I have a question." He said, "What's your question?" He said, "You left me in this particular classroom as someone to make sure that there is no chaos in the class." He said, "Yes." He said, "Why did you do so?" He said, "It's natural, it's rational. If I just walk out, the students will be all over the place. They will commit all kinds of things." Yes? The student looks at him and says, "We are only 20 students. And you made sure that I am there to ensure that there is no chaos. Yet you expect Allah and His Messenger to leave the religion of Islam after the Prophet of Islam without appointing a successor?" What was interesting was that this particular very carefully worded comparison caused the teacher to be upset. He looks at him and says, "How dare you teach me religion? I teach you. So you are suspended. You are expelled from the school. You go to the head teacher and he will sign your papers." He went to the head teacher. The head teacher said to him, "Tomorrow you bring your legal guardian, your wali, someone who's in charge of you, yes? And we sign the papers and you are out of the school." Next day, the boy comes, knocks on the door of the head teacher. Head teacher says, "Come in." He comes in. He says, "Where's your wali?" He says, "Outside." He says, "Call him." He calls him. Who is it? His friend. The head teacher looks at him and says, "How dare you? I told you, bring your wali, someone who's in charge of you." He looks at him and says, "Sir, it's your fault." He says, "My fault?" He says, "Yes. So you've been teaching us all our lives that Mawla and wali means friend. Therefore, I brought my friend." He said, "Don't you mock me. I know what I'm saying. I told you wali meaning someone who's in charge of you." He said, "That's why we Shia believe. When Ali ibn Abi Talib was raised, his hand was put up by the Holy Prophet on the day of Ghadir and said, 'Man kuntu mawla, fahadha Aliun mawla.' The Prophet said, 'Whomsoever, I have complete authority.' Ali has complete authority."
Ya Ali,
Allahumma salli
ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
The recognition, therefore, means what? That istighfar, like many other terms, have many different meanings. Did you know that we have many reliable narrations from the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam that says, whatever you do, do istighara, whatever action. If I don't explain this hadith, people like me, Sheikh Salim, Sheikh Noor, will be 24 hours istikhara. Yes. What is this hadith meaning? These ahadith, you know what I'm saying? They're saying istikhara, that is at the first level, is just the dua, asking Allah if it's khair to do something. That is the first level of istikhara. Sometimes what people do is, they look at the meaning of a term and they limit it to something. Istikhara means seeking khair. Ya Allah, I'm about to leave for the mosque. Ya Allah, I'm about to, for example, go shopping. Ya Allah, I'm about to travel. I want this to be khair. That's istikhara. That's istikhara at the first level. Yes, there is the other. But many people have confined it to what? The other meaning, which is much less mentioned in a hadith. The recognition when it comes to istighfar is what? It means protection. Allama Tabatabai in Al-Mizan beautifully mentions, he says, istighfar here is in reference to awliyaullah, the friends of Allah, the Prophet saying, Ya Allah, we want protection from sins. We want to be at the level where we are raised, yes, so that these sins do not in any shape or form impact us. The Prophet of Islam used to do istighfar 70 times a day. Why? Because sometimes it rubs off. He himself does not commit any mistakes or errors or sins. But sometimes it's like passive sinning, yes. It rubs off on an individual, doesn't want that around him, yes? And therefore this istighfar is in no reference to any sins or mistakes or any act of disobedience, but rather asking Allah for protection from anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is displeased with. That's one understanding. Another very important is in the Quran there is a tool which in Arabic means إِيَّاكَ عَنِي وَاسْمَعِيَّا جَارَ. This is what? This is in reference to the Ahl al-Bayt alayhum as-salam, and the Quran before that using tools addressing a particular individual, but it's in reference to everyone else. For example, the holy two Imams al-Hasanain, Imam al-Hasan and Hussein salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim ajma'in. You've all heard the story. It's taught to us in madrasa, isn't it? When they taught that particular elderly man how to perform wudu, how did they do it? Did they come to him and say, excuse me, your wudu is wrong? No. They said, watch our wudu and see which one is right. And therefore he recognized from this that his wudu was wrong. Quran sometimes seemingly is addressing the Prophet, but it's about everyone else. Because the Prophet is the recipient of the message. The Prophet is receiving. When the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wastaghfirillah, it is not reference to the Holy Prophet or the Ahlul Bayt. It's a reference for you and I. Yes. When we make mistakes, when we slip up, when there are errors. That's the second understanding. And therefore, the recognition that emerges from this particular discussion is what? Is that from the early time of Islamic history, namely from the last few weeks of the life of the Messenger of God, this movement began, which questioned the isma of the Messenger of God. There are some who say it actually began before, because we have instances of some of the companions of the Prophet of Islam disobeying the Prophet. For example, in the year 8 after Hijrah, when he left with an army towards Mecca, as soon as they left Medina, he said to them, it was a month of Ramadan, 10th of Ramadan they left. He said to them, it's time to break the fast. The Prophet says, break the fast. Some of them said, no, we will keep fasting. The Prophet said, innahum humul usat. Look at them. They're disobedient to Rasulullah. Don't be surprised today that there are people who go against the Ahlul Bayt. They were there claiming to follow the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt even during their lives. And they exist today without a shadow of a doubt. Yet the movement was manifested by the actions of certain individuals in order to defy the Prophet of Islam and to stamp this belief that, you know what, the Prophet, this is something of his opinion. When he says, give me a pen and paper, I don't have to give him a pen and paper. I can just say, God forbid, ma'adallah. Yes, it was Thursday, 24th of Safar, 4 days before the Prophet of Islam left this world and was martyred. This particular act of disobedience happened. Don't just look at it historically. This is a theological matter. This is the declaration of the disobedience to Rasulullah. Yes, and that's why today when we defend aqidah of isma, yes, we're defending the honor and the integrity of the Messenger of God and the Ahlul Bayt. Wallah, I say this message from the member of the Holy Prophet. There is no school in Islam that honors and defends and protects the sacredness and the honor and the dignity of Rasulullah like the school of Ahlul Bayt. You say to me, how? Today, when we have discussions with our brothers from other schools, normally we have a discussion about wilayah of the Ahlul Bayt, wilayah of Amir al-Mu'mineen. I say to them, wait, just go back a little bit. Talk about how our school views the Prophet and how other schools view the Prophet. Yes, I remember in Mecca a few years ago, yes, actually towards the beginning of the, in the 2000, it was the beginning of this century, when I was taking pictures of the Kaaba, I saw a scholar came to me. He said to me, brother, it's haram. I said to him, why? He said, at the time of the Prophet, taking pictures was haram. So I looked at him and said, but I don't understand that. How is that possible? Yes. He said, just don't argue, it's in Bukhari. I said, brother, there are narrations in Bukhari which are problematic. We can't take every narration.
He said, like what? I said, there are narrations that says the Prophet of Islam contemplated suicide,
God forbid. He said, yes, I know. I said, did you know that three times Bukhari says the Prophet came to the hill of Ghar-e Hira and was about to throw himself from the top of the cliff. And Jibra'il comes to him and says, Ya Rasulullah, don't do it. Why was he contemplating? Because he thought the jinn were what? Possessing him. And that what he heard was not from Jibra'il, not from Allah. And three times he goes back and he goes, and he was about to throw himself. And then he decides not to. I said to him, brother, this is what's in Bukhari. What was the answer? Alhamdulillah, at least he never committed suicide. The problem that we have is what? I will defend others at the expense of the Messenger of God. That's the red line for us. The Holy Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt. Nobody, yes, nobody can ever be defended at their expense. Nobody. And that is why we have to have this aqeedah and understanding. Research it tonight or the next few nights. If you have doubts, if you have questions, let's importantly inculcate these teachings within our hearts, within our children. And that's why when it came to those last few hours of the life of the Messenger of God, it was difficult for the Ahlul Bayt to see how those individuals, the Muslims, treated this great individual. Quran says, the Prophet saved you. وَكُنْتُمْ عَلَىٰ شَفَىٰ حُفْرَةٍ مِّنَ النَّارِ. You were just on the verge of falling into Jahannam. Allah says, the Prophet came and saved you from it. The Prophet of mercy, the Prophet of love, the Prophet of compassion. And yet, the last few days of the life of the Holy Prophet were as such. That's why the narrations that you read about how the Ahlul Bayt dealt with these last few hours. It was no doubt the most difficult moments for Ali Muhammad. No doubt painstakingly hard for them. Not only to bid farewell to a father, to a grandfather, to a brother in the case of Amir al-Mu'mineen, but the best and the choicest of God's creation. How painful it is to think of a world without the beautiful personality of the Messenger of God. And that is why I was looking at the narrations and I found every single member of the Ahlul Bayt would be constantly crying, weeping, when they're next to the Prophet, yes, when they're next to Rasulullah, including Sayyidatul Nisa Fatima, who continued her tears after Rasulullah, isn't it? Who continued to shed those tears in defiance of those who stood against her after the Holy Prophet had left this world. The riwayat tells us that when the Prophet of Islam was breathing his last moments, he gave his advice towards his Ahlul Bayt. He would encourage them to be patient. He would encourage them to be steadfast. He would say to them that the calamities would befall upon you, that you will see much hardship, much difficulties. He would turn towards each and every member of the Ahlul Bayt. He would speak to Amir al-Mu'mineen. He would speak to Sayyida Fatima. He would speak to Imam al-Hassan. He would speak to Imam al-Husayn. He would speak to these individuals and console them. Yes. It is said that when Amir al-Mu'mineen was about to leave this world, he told them what the Prophet of Islam had instructed. Yes. He said to those around him, Amir al-Mu'mineen, when he was struck, he said to them that when Rasulullah was breathing his last, he told me, Ya Ali, when I die, wash my body and shroud me, but I'd like you to use a special kafan. Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen said to him, Ya Rasulullah, tell me, which kafan shall I use? The Prophet said, O Ali, this kafan was given to me by my beloved Almighty through Jibra'il when my beloved Khadija left this world. You remember that we were together where? We were together in Shu'ab of Abi Talib under the sanctions. We had nothing. And I received this kafan. Yes. Ya Ali, this kafan is for five people. It's divided into five. Yes. I have already used one part of it for my beloved Khadija.
Oh Ali, Ya Abul Hassan, use the second for me. The third is for my beloved daughter Fatima. The fourth is for you, Ya Abul Hassan. And the fifth is for my son Hassan al-Mujtaba. Allahu Akbar. Amir al-Mu'mineen is narrating this. Yes, he's telling people around him what is the Prophet's advice, what the Prophet has commanded. Do you know who stood up at that moment? That daughter of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Zainab, she said, Father Ali, what about my brother Hussein? Is there no kafan for Aba Abdullah? Is there no kafan for Maya Hussein? Yes. Amir al-Mu'mineen tells of what happens. And that's why on nights like these, it was Sayyida Zainab who returned to Medina and straight away went to the grave of Rasulullah. Yes, after the tragedy of Karbala, after being held captive in the dungeons of Sham and Kufa, she stands before the grave of Rasulullah. Yes, she calls those, recalls those moments in which she called the Prophet of God. When did she call the Prophet? She called the Prophet in Karbala. She recalled when she called out, Ya Rasulullah, your Hussein is alone on the plains of Karbala. Hussein was still alive, huh? The 12th Holy Imam says that moment when Sayyida Zainab was calling out the Prophet, was calling out Amir al-Mu'mineen, he calls towards his grandfather Hussein. He says, my grandfather Hussein, whilst you were on the plains of Karbala, Umar ibn Sa'ad said to the horses, trample on his body. Oh Aba Abdullah, you were still alive when you felt the hooves of the horses on your chest and they broke your ribs, Ya Hussein. Yes. Sayyida Zainab looks at the grave of the Holy Prophet and the poet says, Ya Rasulullah, it's as if she says, Ya Rasulullah, yes, where shall I start when it comes to the musibah of your beloved Hussein? Allahu Akbar. Which musibah shall I start with, Ya Rasulullah? Shall I tell you of Akbar who looked like you and may hit him on his head and split his head? Ya Rasulullah, shall I tell you, oh my grandfather, of my sons Aun and Muhammad? I never shed a tear for them. Oh Rasulullah, shall I tell you of that Abbas? That Abbas that was my protector. That Abbas that had an arrow on his left eyes. That Abbas that had his arms amputated. Ya Rasulullah, which musibah shall I tell you? Shall I inform you of that radi', that infant who had an arrow down his throat? Ya Rasulullah, I had to carry that infant. I had to indeed present that infant to his mother Rabab. Ya Rasulullah, Ya Nabi Allah, wajadda. There is one sight I can never describe for you, Ya Rasulullah. That one sight that I saw Shimr walk towards Aba Abdullah. Ya Rasulullah, I called out, is there anyone amongst you who is Muslim? Is there anyone who will stop this? Ya Messenger, I saw Shimr sit on the chest of Hussein. I saw him take out a dagger. He looked at the eyes of Rayhul Imam. He looked at him. He held his beard and stabbed him many times. Allahu Akbar. Tonight we are gathered here, we're remembering the Prophet, but in Medina there are no majalis next to Rasulullah. There is no aza next to Rasulullah. Yes. Here I remember a poem that is written. It's as if Medina is speaking toward Karbala. Medina is saying to Karbala, what is it saying? It's saying, oh Karbala, oh Karbala, where are the domes of Baqi'? Why, oh why, I do not have any visitors. Where are the mokibs and where are the ma'tams? Where is the ziyara? Where is the ones who hold the majalis for Rasulullah? It's as if Medina, the soul of Medina, is saying to Karbala, why do I not have these shrines? Why do I not have these majalis? Karbala responds, oh Medina, I know what you saw. Allahu Akbar. Oh Medina, oh Medina, did you see what I saw? Tell me, what did you see? Karbala says, I know you saw the broken ribs of Fatima. I know you saw Fatima crushed between the wall and the door, but let me tell you, I on my ground, I felt the hooves destroy and place the bodies of Aba Abdullah in several pieces. I saw the women being chased from one place to another. I saw the daughter of Hussein ears being ripped.
وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين وإنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. We raise our hands on a night like this. Those tears, those acts of devotion, this attendance in the majlis of Rasulullah. We are the lovers of Rasulullah. We die for Rasulullah. We will defend Rasulullah, his honor and his integrity. We will defend his asma until the every last moment of our life. We raise our hands and we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, raise us with Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Ya Allah, allow us to see the Prophet of Islam and the Ahlul Bayt after we die. Ya Allah, allow us to visit the shrine of Rasulullah in dunya, and allow us to see the day in which the shrines of the Imams of Baqi are rebuilt again. Ya Allah, allow us to hold majalis in Medina openly and freely. Ya Allah, protect the shrines of the Ahlul Bayt. Grant mu'mineen and mu'minat who have hajat, who are ill, who have requested that we remember them in dua. Ya Allah, fulfill the wishes, Ya Rabb al-Alameen. Ya Allah, hasten the reappearance of our 12th Imam and make us of the devout and sincere followers. Ma'tam Hussein, Ya Hussein.
Ya Nabi, 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 Salli ala Mustafa, Ali Mustafa. 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 Inki badolat khuda ka din bach gaya. Salli ala Mustafa, Ali Mustafa. Salli ala Mustafa, Ali Mustafa. Salli ala Mustafa, Ali Mustafa. Allah ke habib hai aur naam Mustafa. Rehmat hai alameen pe sardar anbiya. Ummaton hi pe karti rahi zulm aur jafa. Lekin kadam kadam pe wo dete rahe dua. Salli ala Mustafa, Ali Mustafa. Salli ala Mustafa, Ali Mustafa. Inki badolat khuda ka din bach gaya.
صلي على مصطفى آل مصطفى بر کر بلندیوں نے کہا ہے جسے علی اللہ کا ولی ہے محمد کا ہے وسی بعد رسول اس پہ ہی تلوار چل گئی خون میں نہا کے جس نے کیا شکر کی دریا صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ ان کی بدولت خدا کا دین بچ گیا صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ اٹھتے تھے احترام میں جس کے لیے رسول خالق کی حجتوں پہ جو حجت ہے وہ بتول ہائے ستم اسی کی گواہی نہ کی قبول مٹ جاتی کائنات جو دے دی وہ بدعا صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ ان کی بدولت خدا کا دین بچ گیا صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ ہے دوسرا چراغ ہدایت شہ زمن جو ہو بہو شبی ہے محمد ہے وہ حسن پردیس بن گیا تھا اسی کے لیے وطن تابوت جس کا تیروں کی بارش میں گر گیا صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ ان کی بدولت خدا کا دین بچ گیا صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ شہ نے کیا وہ کام جو کوئی نہ کر سکا خواجہ معین نے بھی یہی برملا کہا شبیر کی وہ ذات ہے جس پر کے با خدا ہے انہی سارے اشہد اللہ الہ کا صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ ان کی بدولت خدا کا دین بچ گیا صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ پروردگار صبر ہے غیرت کا ہے خدا سجاد صبر و ربط و تحمل کی انتہا بلوے میں جس نے دیکھا ہے زینب کو بے ردا کہتے ہیں اس کے صبر پہ اللہ و انبیاء صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ ان کی بدولت خدا کا دین بچ گیا صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ صلی علی مصطفیٰ آل مصطفیٰ
یا حسین
یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین یا حسین
یا حسین حسین
یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا
حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو
حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک کے دامن سے آ رہی ہے فلک کے دامن سے آ رہی ہے حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک کے دامن سے آ رہی ہے فلک کے دامن سے آ رہی ہے
حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو
حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو
فلک کے دامن سے آ رہی ہے
فلک کے دامن سے آ رہی ہے
یہ خون ناحک چھپے گا کیوں کر
یہ خون ناحک چھپے گا کیوں کر جسے یہ دنیا چھپا رہی ہے حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو حسین تیرے لہو
لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے, فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے.
حسین لاشا جوا کلے کر,
حسین لاشا جوا کلے کر,
چلے ہیں مقتل سے سوئے خیمہ,
چلے ہیں مقتل سے سوئے خیمہ.
مگر ضعیفی قدم قدم پر,
مگر ضعیفی قدم قدم پر,
اٹھا رہی ہے بٹھا رہی ہے
حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو, حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے, فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے. یا حسین حسین یا حسین, یا حسین حسین یا حسین, یا حسین حسین یا حسین, یا حسین حسین یا حسین.
یہ کون ہے جس کی گفتگو میں,
یہ کون ہے جس کی گفتگو میں,
علی کا لہجہ جلک رہا ہے,
علی کا لہجہ جلک رہا ہے.
یہ کون ہے جس کے ولولوں میں,
یہ کون ہے جس کے ولولوں میں, حسینیت جگمگا رہی ہے حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو, حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے, فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے.
برہنا سر ہے علی کی بیٹی,
برہنا سر ہے علی کی بیٹی,
مگر وہی عظمت محمد,
مگر وہی عظمت محمد,
وہ جس کی خاطر بھرا ہوا گر,
وہ جس کی خاطر بھرا ہوا گر,
لٹا کے کربل سے آ رہی ہے
حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو, حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے, فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے. یا حسین حسین یا حسین, یا حسین حسین یا حسین, یا حسین حسین یا حسین, یا حسین حسین یا حسین.
پکاری دشت بلا میں زینب,
پکاری دشت بلا میں زینب,
کہا ہو واپس لوٹ آؤ,
کہا ہو واپس لوٹ آؤ.
اٹھا کے ہاتھوں میں خالی کوزا,
اٹھا کے ہاتھوں میں خالی کوزا, سکینہ تم کو بلا رہی ہے حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو, حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے, فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے.
بجا کے پیکا سے پیاس اپنی,
بجا کے پیکا سے پیاس اپنی,
جو گرم ریتی پہ سو رہا ہے,
جو گرم ریتی پہ سو رہا ہے.
تجھے خیالوں میں ابھی اصغر,
تجھے خیالوں میں ابھی اصغر, رباب جھولا جھولا رہی ہے حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو, حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے, فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے. یا حسین حسین یا حسین, یا حسین حسین یا حسین, یا حسین حسین یا حسین, یا حسین حسین یا حسین.
دیار شام و دیار کوفہ,
دیار شام و دیار کوفہ,
جو ہو کے آئی ہے بنت زہرا,
جو ہو کے آئی ہے بنت زہرا.
نبی کے روزے پہ جاتے جاتے,
نبی کے روزے پہ جاتے جاتے,
نشار حسن کے چھپا رہی ہے
حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو, حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے, فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے.
کہاں ہے مقتل کہاں مدینہ,
کہاں ہے مقتل مقتل کہا مدینہ
طرف کے بولی اے ام سلمہ
طرف کے بولی اے ام سلمہ
جو غش سے جاگی ہے تیری صغرا
جو غش سے جاگی ہے تیری صغرا بس ایک نوحہ سنا رہی ہے حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین
پکاری داشت بلا میں زینب
پکاری داشت بلا میں زینب
کہاں ہو عباس لوٹ آؤ
کہاں ہو عباس لوٹ آؤ
اٹھا کے ہاتھوں میں خالی کوزا
اٹھا کے ہاتھوں میں خالی کوزا سکینہ تم کو بلا رہی ہے حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے
یا حسین
حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین
حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو
حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو
فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے
فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے
یہ خون ناحق چھپے گا کیوں کر
یہ خون ناحق چھپے گا کیوں کر جسے یہ دنیا چھپا رہی ہے حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو حسین تیرے لہو کی خوشبو فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے فلک دامن سے آ رہی ہے یا حسین حسین یا حسین 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 حسین یا حسین حسین یا حسین